So we are very glad to have you with us, sir. And I am Madhura, and I'll be the moderator for this session of ETA. So, sir, what is your entrepreneurial journey? Please tell us about that.
Sure. Thanks a lot for having me, and thanks for hosting this amazing event. My journey started way back in 2014, when I had just graduated, just like you guys, just graduated from college with a bachelor's degree from RV College in Bangalore. Just after that, I was kind of thinking, what should I do? What should I do, an MS or an MBA? So sort of confusions that you get when you just graduate. And after working in the industry for a while, I worked in the industry here in Bangalore. I got an admit into a college in the US called Texas A&M University. So I did my master's there in the US. It's an amazing experience, doing my master's. Very different life-changing experience, I would say, doing my master's in the US. And I just before my graduation, I was able to get an opportunity to work do a co-op in Tesla, in the powertrain manufacturing department. And this was a life-changing moment for me, where I was able to see some of the very innovative cutting-edge technologies that were implemented in the Silicon Valley with Tesla. And just after that, I had the option of working in the industry with another company called Velodyne LiDAR. So LiDAR manufacturing is basically used for self-driving cars. So again, it's a key component or key hardware for self-driving cars. And I worked as a process, manufacturing process engineer for a span of 1 year before I decided to, come back to India and, start something of my own. And that's where my, entrepreneurial journey started. It's been a long journey with a lot of ups and downs, a lot of learning lessons, which, over the span of, over the period of months, I was able to learn. Just after, finishing my, leaving my job in the US, in the Silicon Valley, and coming back, I had this idea, a social media mobile application, where I thought that students or people who are interested in sharing subscription accounts can use a social media account to share other subscriptions by just putting it up on the platform and then seeing if other people are interested to share. So that was my first idea. So when I first had this idea, I didn't know what to do, how to start things, what's the way to go ahead with the startup. And then I started working with a a partner of mine, started doing a lot of the UI UX, finding looking for people to for investors, trying to market this product. And just about 6 months down the line, we figured out that it was not working. It was a lot of challenges that we had anticipated, and we decided to call it quits. And I then proceeded to convert this. We had. I mean, I'm based in Bangalore, and I proceeded to convert this, a family-owned office space into a co-working space. So basically, for all these startups who are, up and coming, could come and, work out of here and start sharing ideas and thoughts. That was my main idea, and it was after a few months of, struggling here and there, it was a good success. We mean, until recently, we had about 90% occupancy, five startups working out of here. And about 8 months ago, that's where we got this. I mean, I got this idea with a couple of my co-founders right now, the idea of road metrics. So road metrics is what we do with road metrics is that we map road conditions using image and sensor data. So this idea was born with my co-founders, who were using this as a college project, something very inspiring for me. If you guys are taking any kind of projects, that is very inspiring, I would say. So this project was taken up by the Surat Municipal Corporation. So they're graduates from Gujarat Technological University. The Surat Municipal Corporation reached out to them, saying that this is a fantastic idea. Mapping road conditions using image and sensor data from a smartphone can be a very useful feature for townships, authorities, the public, and infrastructure firms. And that's when we started building our product, building our platform, and we got in through an early stage startup investor called 100x.vc. So 100x.vc is an early stage startup investment VC fund, which is led by Sanjay Mehta. Sanjay Mehta has previously invested in companies like OYO, Box8, and so on. And yeah, so since then, a lot of things have happened. We built our team from a team of three right now to we built a team to a team of five. We've also been able to get a couple of major deals, such as in the city of Jamshedpur in which is owned by Tata, Jesco. We were able to do a complete mapping of road conditions, and also the city of Chennai and Jaipur. We had some projects with Mahindra's origin cities. So that's been the journey so far. A lot of ups and downs, a lot of learning lessons, but an amazing journey. And then I think been able to learn a lot of things as I progress through my journey on the entrepreneurial side. So that's kind of my overview of how my journey has been.
Yeah. Sir, what are your future plans about Road Metrics?
Yeah. So what we do with Road Metrics is it's an end-to-end solution for infrastructure companies and township authorities. Now, the way things work at the moment, it's all manually done. So we have a couple of competitors in the US called Roadbotics and Violetics. What they've been able to do achieve so far is that this road assessment and road conditions mapping can be used for all the budget allocations. Now, if any infra firm who does a road maintenance work, we'll be able to map and pinpoint the whole platform as to how the road network looks, right? And they can also prioritize the maintenance. Like, for example, certain stretches of roads can always be targeted because they have issues like waterlogging, issues like recurrent issues like encroachments, different vehicular movements. So we're trying to build an analytics into this. So the plan in the future right now is to get into all these big infrastructure firms. We are currently working with a couple of them who have clients all across India, as well as Southeast Asia. Our plan is to become the default, a road condition and maintenance application for any infra project. Take it L&T, if you take it as, Metalite, like many groups who deal with a lot of infra firms. This will be the, official technology, software or a platform for them to do all the road maintenance and road, mapping. Well, that's our, our goal going in the coming months and years.
Sir, like at the beginning of your startup, so how did you get your funding and how difficult it was to get the funding?
Got it. So as far as startup funding goes, it depends on a lot of case. It's a very case by case thing where. If you are doing something like an innovative idea, for example, our idea was not done somewhere, some other company before. It's the mapping of road conditions using machine learning. It's a deep tech company which is trying to solve a big problem. VC, there's Techstars in Bangalore. These are all these early stage investors who invest a small amount and help you, mentorship as you grow up, as you scale up. So yeah, so a lot of challenges, but yeah, if you were able to sell your vision and you have a good team, since we had a team which is kind of well rounded, I had my co-founders who are into computer science. I'm into operations and, business side of things with my background. So we were able to get that right team and, the right story that we could sell. And since then, it's been quite good so far. Yeah.
Sir, apart from these fundings, did you get any funding from the government?
Yeah, so we did apply for a couple of government grants, which was recent. But due to the situation, it has been slowed down a little bit. We have these innovation grants from the Indian government, as well as a couple of other grants that are abroad as well. Like the UK government has something as an innovation kind of award. We were getting through the certain stages, but due to COVID, it slowed down a little bit. But we are in the process of getting through that. There exists a lot of these grants available for deep tech companies or doing something that's R&D, really solving a big problem. So there are grants which a lot of companies do get. We are in the process of doing that.
Sir, this idea of road metrics is such an unique idea. I mean, how does this idea come up? Like any motivation behind this or like anything?
Yeah, so my co-founder actually came up with the idea where while in college, in the third year of engineering, they kind of were using Google Maps for their navigation needs. And they got an alternative map option where you get another route where you can go from a shortcut, right? For example, a shortcut. So that's when they found out that shortcut actually didn't save them time. It was a dead end. It's a block road. So that's when I figured out that Google Maps does not have a localized solution for Indian road conditions. And with the advent of new technology coming in, like TensorFlow and machine learning and so on, it is now possible to map road conditions with just a simple smartphone where you send by GPS coordinates and you use machine learning to classify road data. It can be from early stage cracks to final stage potholes. So that's when the idea came. And after some market research, a competitor analysis, we also found that we had competitors doing kind of similar work in the US and Europe as well. And they were able to achieve kind of some good success on this. And that's when we found out that, okay, there's this big problem here. We have the technology to solve it. And why not, start building this and start mapping the whole cities. That's when we mapped the whole city of Surat and we got to deal with the Surat Municipal Corporation. And then later we mapped the whole city of Bangalore. It's about 1,000 kilometers. And also now Jamshedpur with Tata. So yeah, that's when the idea came up. It's a unique idea, which I think the main motivation here is that the problem that was to be solved. So bad road conditions is a big problem here in India. And that's when we thought that technology could kind of solve this problem. So yeah, that's the motivation or the inspiration behind the idea.
Well, sir, we also have some questions from the audience.
Sure.
So the question is, final year college projects assigned by professors are hardly taken seriously by certain students. Do you think letting students take up self-project which interests them, it can be of any field, might act as a small step towards encouraging small ventures in the country?
Yeah, definitely. I'm a big proponent or I'm a big supporter of such initiatives, like such projects that are going on. A lot of these innovative solutions and ideas come up during, when projects take place in college. One of the biggest, one of the biggest advantages that, a college student will have is that your learning starts from while you're in college, right? So that's something which, so your learning starts while you're in college. So, and the good, one of the things that about, entrepreneurship is that you'll have a lot of failures on the way. So you might find a lot of rejections, a lot of, learning lessons. And the earlier you do it, the sooner you start, getting this experience that this is how you should do it. This is what you should do. And so on. That's when you have that unique advantage. And starting it right away in college gives you that, immense, opportunity or, advantage when it comes to startups. And that's something which, I was, wondering, like, if I had done it a little more sooner, I would have had more time. So it's kind of like you're in the right time to start thinking of innovative ideas where you have that intersection between knowledge, your professors kind of helping you as well, or even the industry as well. So you can start connecting with people and seeing, trying to see if you can fill in loopholes in the system.
And sir, who was Mr. Nikhil Prasad Maroli at the age of 18 or 19? Like, who was he?
That's a very tough question to answer. I mean, I'm a big tennis. I'm a big tennis enthusiast. I used to play for my university tennis as well, and I was just engrossed in extracurricular activities like playing tennis for my university. I was trying to explore new ideas. I had just gotten into college. I was trying to see if during the summer I can do some kind of app development work, learn programming on my own. because my field is into manufacturing and mechanical engineering side of it, but I also had some interest in, you know, interdisciplinary fields. So I feel in the next coming years, AI will be, you know, one of the key, you know, components of the future, where India has a good opportunity going abroad, like, you know, going ahead in the future. AI gives unlocks us a lot of opportunities, and a lot of jobs in the future will be based on that. And it requires a very interdisciplinary approach. Now, for example, if you are a mechanical engineer and you have some knowledge on coding and AI, you can try to see some, you know, intersection between these two on a unique project or something, which you can do during your summer internships or during your, you know, projects while in college, so on. So I think, yeah, so when I was 18, 19, I was just, you know, trying to explore these things, learn some, you know, things like programming on my own. And yeah, try and look at some projects that I could, you know, implement. Yeah, that's
Sir, we again have a question from audience from our Facebook Live. He is Priyansh Kotliar. Greetings from ESL VSSUT. Having a co-founder is great, but hard to find. Eventually, I started my venture alone. Is it good alone, or should I consider adding people?
Got it. So yeah, when I first started as well, I mean, my first, you know, the co-working space that I had done and all of that, I faced a similar challenge where I didn't know many people. I didn't know, you know, who to find the best person for a, you know, a company, right? So that's when it's something like you, the best way to do it is like you start with the company, and then once you start, you know, promoting it, start marketing it, people who are interested in your field, like, you know, like-minded people will start approaching you themselves, and then they will be able to kind of, you know, you'll be able to find people who are interested. So ideally, yes, it would be good to have a co-founder, but, you know, you should start first and then, you know, start looking at, you know, getting a co-founder, start networking with people more. A good idea would be to, you know, just use LinkedIn as, I mean, a very useful tool right now. When I was a student, it was not as popular as I guess it is right now. So you find a lot of like-minded people, you know, sharing, you know, their thoughts, sharing their projects, and so on. And it's just a matter of, you know, connecting with them and then, you know, sharing your ideas. So that's a very, you know, powerful tool, I would say. And then also, obviously, like, you know, career fairs or, you know, networking opportunities in different cities. Like, for example, in Bangalore, in place, we have a lot of these co-founder meeting sessions. It happens a lot here. And I think Bangalore has been able to get a lot of unicorns in the past few years. And this unique, you know, culture where a lot of startups are born out of this particular area has helped a lot for, you know, people who are interested in that. So again, yeah, networking events, using LinkedIn as a powerful tool, it will definitely work out where you start promoting it and then you find, you know, someone who is interested.
Sir, we again have a question from an audience from Facebook Live. Ayush Datta, he's saying, what do you think about startup with a blogging website just to know about business and its world?
Yeah, it definitely. So I think it's a very good idea to have that. You know, seeing a lot of the successful startups that you see in the past few years, not just in India, but in the Silicon Valley, in the US as well, is that you'll find startups which were first, you know, like side projects. They were actually not, you know, companies that were like born right out of, you know, just coming out and doing it. For example, companies like Shopify. So Shopify was a side project that they had found a, you know, problem in the market, and they thought that this solution could solve it. Similarly, that HubSpot, you know, and then there's a tool called the Skim. So these are many startups which were born out of a need. Like, they were trying to find out, experiment what's the need in the market, and having blogs and increasing your subscriber base is very useful to, you know, find out what your customer needs, what your passions are, and, you know, what works out the best. Once you do that, then you will start getting, you know, a better idea of how the customer needs are. So a blog is a very good idea. I think it's a good thing to, you know, start with that and, you know, start sharing your thoughts and ideas as soon as possible.
Yeah. Sir, there are many budding entrepreneurs right there. Yeah. So what would be your message for them? I mean, like, what would be your suggestion for them to go ahead with their ideas or innovation? So what will be your message for them?
Yeah, I would say, like, you know, don't worry about any failures. This is going to be a part of, you know, the journey if you're going to do something of your own, you know, your own startup. So start, you know, start finding problems in the industry, start finding problems in, you know, society where you think where you can solve it using your technology that you have, like all of your engineering graduates, right? So I'm sure there are a lot of ways where technology can come in and try to solve big, problems in society. And a lot of the startups were born out of this, out of this kind of method. So I would say start right away, start doing projects, start looking at innovative solutions where you can use your, knowledge to build, a nice solution. And becoming, big and starting, getting more traction is just a matter of you finding the right product market fit. So if you find the need in the market, you have the right solution, you can start slowly scaling up. So it's like, you fail, you might get the right, success. And again, you keep trying more and more. So don't be afraid of failures. Just start doing projects, look at new innovative ideas. I'm sure in the next coming years, in the next few years, we'll have a lot of, new cutting edge startups coming up in India. So I think it's my, motivation for you guys. Hopefully, we have some new unicorns coming up. Yeah.
Sir, we again have a question from Sreyan Datta. How to understand what is the right time to launch a particular product or a service or technology, because the general consumer might not be aware of the technological advancement and the purpose it would serve in their daily life?
Yeah. Again, so the key here would be to, go with a very lean approach. So by lean, what do I mean by lean? So I can give an example of Tesla. So I worked in Tesla for a while, right? So the way Tesla started was they thought that there's a need. So they felt that consumers want a different, a different experience than a traditional car. And a new, an electric car has a lot of advantage when it comes to performance. It has instant torque. And when they first started, the first Tesla model, that is a Roadster, right? So that is a sports car. It was not a production line, car where they had their own factory. It was basically, an outsourced shell of the body, which is imported by Lotus. Lotus is another company which manufactures cars. So they just got in the shells of the cars, put in their, their own electric, motor, and, tested it out and got some response from the market. So a lot of them were excited. They kind of gave them the idea that, okay, so we're very interested in an electric car, which does well and which, has a different experience. By getting that, kind of a response from the public that this is interesting or this is something which we would like to pay for, then they started, building on more and more. So then they got an own production plant, raised more funds. Similarly, there are a lot of, startups who've done in the similar lean methodology. So if you were not, if you're not able to get the response from the public, build something very small, like a very, a minimum, it's called an MVP, right? A minimum viable product. Build something very bare essentials. Like, for example, if you're solving a particular problem about delivery of, say, groceries in a particular area, do they actually worry about the time or do they worry about quality? So only when you start delivering and start, engaging with the customers, will you understand that there's a need for it. So try to do something, try to sell it to them, build the product or something, and then you start, slowly adding on more features, more ideas. So you should get the right product market fit. That's the main, the key concept here.
Okay, sir. So the next question we have from Akash Chaube. He's saying, is it necessary to register your startup first?
Not really. I mean, you don't have to. I mean, unless you really wanted to, because you'll incur a lot of charges on the legal side. When you started, and you'll have to work with your compliances, all of that. So accounting, taxes, and all of these things, right? So you can always start as a project that you have with your, you or your friends, and start building things. And once you start that, you have some kind of idea that this is a need in the market, and then there's some kind of, potential, and you're able to sell something, you can obviously, then you can go in and start your own company on the legal side. In terms of the costs that you have to incur, it's not a lot. It is just that if you are really, interested in having a company, you can just, register it right away. It's just that you have to maintain your, accounting, legal, compliances and so on. It's not a big deal. You can either choose this or that. But if you want to just, start experimenting new things, a lot of things, you can just do projects and then find out the best one and then go ahead with it. So it's just a matter of opinion or preference, I would say. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much for your visionary thoughts. And it has enlightened the young minds right there, out there. And we are very glad that you are amongst us as one of our keynote speakers for eTalk 2020. And thank you so much, sir, for making our virtual eSummit 2020 a fruitful experience for all the budding entrepreneurs out there. Thank you so much, sir.
Thanks a lot for having me. Wish you the best and good luck on your future ventures.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.